Hey everybody, welcome to Beaming Knots, and today we're going to look at the summary of the poem Birches by Robert Frost. Setting of the poem. The poem is set in a birch forest where the narrator spots a birch tree or probably multiple trees bending down due to the ice storm. The forest is probably in the countryside. Robert Frost has lived most of his life in the countryside, so it's no wonder that nature would play an important role in his poems. Summary, lines 1 to 7. When I see birches bend to left and right, across the lines of straighter, darker trees, I like to think some boy has been swinging them, but swinging doesn't bend them down to stay, as ice storms do. Often, you must have seen them, loaded with ice, a sunny winter morning after a rain. The poem consists of 59 lines in total. The poem is not in a stanza format, so we are dividing it into stanzas with thematic resemblances to help in our analysis of the poem. So let's start. In these lines, the poet, after having spotted a birch tree in a wood, starts thinking of the possible causes for the bending of the birch trees. First, he thinks of a boy who's been swinging them, and that may be the reason for the bending of the tree. But he soon realizes that the only act of swinging does not make the trees bend down to stay, as ice storms do. So indirectly, he wants to imply the fact that ice storm is a cause for the bending. Then the first person narrator addresses the audience or the reader of the poem as you and wants the reader to remember having seen them loaded with ice a sunny winter morning after a rain. Summary, lines 7 to 13. They click upon themselves as a breeze rises and turn many colored, as the stir cracks and crazes their enamel. Soon the sun's warmth makes them shed crystal shells, shattering and avalanching on the snow crust. Such heaps of broken glass to sweep away, you would think the inner dome of heaven had fallen. The poet goes on to describe the behavior of the trees as they click upon themselves. As the breeze rises and how they turn many colored, as the stir cracks and crazes their enamel, soon after rising of the sun, the ice melts away, shedding their crystal shells, shattering and avalanching on the snow crust. Evidently, the snows have frozen into crystals, and when they melt, they crack and craze through their enamels or the outer layer. And after the initial melting, the shattered ice collects below the tree as if it were a pile of glass being swept into dustpan. Then the poet adds a beautiful allegorical line which heightens the beauty of the poem to a different level. He compares the broken snow crusts as if the inner dome of heaven had fallen. Summary, lines 14 to 20. They are dragged to the withered bracken by the load, and they seem not to break, though once they are bowed. So low for long, they never right themselves. You may see their trunks arching in the woods, years afterwards trailing their leaves on the ground, like girls on hands and knees that throw their hair before them over their heads to dry in the sun. In these lines, the poet or the narrator describes the birch trees dragged to the withered bracken by the load, under the weight of ice and snow. But they don't break themselves, as the poet is hopeful that they will right themselves, although bending low for long. But sometimes they might get permanently bent for long years, trailing their leaves on the ground, or in other words, they get broken. Then the narrator compares these trees with their bending trunks like girls on hands and knees that throw their hair before them over their heads to dry in the sun. Summary, lines 21 to 32. But I was going to say, when truth broke in, with all her matter of fact about the ice storm, I should prefer to have some boy bend them, as he went out and in to fetch the cows, some boy too far from town to learn baseball, whose only play was what he found himself, summer or winter, and could play alone. One by one he subdued his father's trees, by riding them down over and over again. until he took the stiffness out of them, and not one but hung limp, not one was left for him to conquer. The poet prefers to be in his fancy world as he comes to know about the hard reality of the bending of the trees, that is the ice storm. The poet is trying to avoid the reality here. He likes to think some boy has bended them on his way back home after herding his cows. Some boy who is too far from town to learn baseball, whose only play was what he found himself, summer or winter. The poet likes to imagine the boy going out to his father's orchard and climbing his father's trees by riding them down over and over again until he took the stiffness out of them, leaving not a single tree left for him to conquer. If we look at this line from a psychoanalytic point of view, then this can be seen as overpowering, the father figure which every boy from his childhood tries to master in his unconscious mind. Summary, lines 32 to 41. He learned all there was to learn about not launching out too soon, and so not carrying the tree away clear to the ground. He always kept his poise to the top branches, climbing carefully with same pains you use to fill a cup up to the brim, and even above the brim. Then he flung outward, feet first, with a swish, kicking his way down through the air to the ground. So was I once, myself, a swinger of birches. The boy has now become an expert in bending the trees, as he has learned all there was to learn about not launching out too soon, and so not carrying the tree away clear to the ground. He's meticulous in climbing the trees, keeping the poise till he reaches the top branches. The narrator compares the pains he takes each time he climbs a tree with filling of a cup to the brim or even above the brim. And after reaching the top, he jumps straight to the ground with a swish, kicking his way down through the air. All these remind the poet of his own childhood experiences when he, like the boy, used to swing birches. So was I, once myself, a swinger of birches. Summary, lines 42 to 49. And so I dream of going back to be. It's when I'm weary of considerations, and life is too much like pathless wood, where your face burns and tickles with the cobwebs broken across it, and one eye is weeping from a twig's having lashed across it open. I'd like to get away from earth a while, and then come back to it and begin over. The poet has become weary from his responsibilities as an adult in this tough world where one has to maintain a rational outlook. That's why the narrator wants to go back to his childhood, where once again he can enjoy all those little enjoyments. He feels lost. Now to him, life seems to be like a pathless wood where your face burns and tickles with cobwebs. So, the narrator wants to get away from the earth for a while and then come back again to restart his life fresh. The strong sense of escapism is evident in these lines, as common with the romantic poets like Wordsworth, Keats, Byron, etc. Summary, lines 50 to 59. May no fate willfully misunderstand me and half grant what I wish and snatch me away not to return. Earth's the right place for love. I don't know where it's likely to go better. I'd like to go by climbing a birch tree and climb black branches up a snow-white trunk toward heaven till the tree could bear no more but dipped its top and set me down again. That would be good both going and coming back. One could do worse than be a swinger of birches. The poet wants the fates to half grant him a wish to go away from this world, from his responsibilities. The word half grant is of importance here as he does not want to go away permanently. He wants to return to this world as he thinks earth to be the right place for love. Earth's the right place for love. He doesn't know any better place to go than earth. But then he thinks of going to heaven by climbing a birch tree till the tree could bear no more, but dipped its top and set me down again. The poem ends on a lighter note, stating that one could do worse than be a swinger of birches. Central idea. The poem is reminiscent of the poems of the Romantics. Nostalgic, dreamy, escapist, it has all the qualities of any other romantic poems. The poem opens by giving the possible explanations of the bending of the birch trees. Then the poet goes on to explain the beauty of the crystallized snows and ice-capped trees. The poet imagines a boy bending the branches while returning after herding his cows. The poet again mentions another boy bending the branches of the trees in his father's orchard. And this reminds the poet of his similar childhood experiences. He expresses his desire to go away from his world of responsibilities and return to his childhood once again, so that he could start his life afresh from the beginning. He wants the fates to grant him a half wish, as he doesn't want to go away permanently from this world, but to come back again, because after some considerations, he reconciles to the idea that Earth is the best place for love. The theme or the central idea of Birches is the interrelationship between reality and imagination. The poem knows very well that the bending of birches can be brought about by an ice storm. Yet, he prefers to think that it is done by some energetic prankster. The poem illustrates the poet's ability to take what seems to be mundane activities of life and turn it into something that holds deeper meaning. The poem revolves around a boy living in the countryside whose only play was what he found himself, in this case, riding birch branches. On a more deeper and figurative level, we also find the theme of life and death underlying in the poem. The poem writes a lot of meditations on life and death, bringing forth some elements of spirituality. Moreover, Birches is a poem about truth. Truth is at times cold and uninviting. A pinch of fantasy makes the truth appealing and wondrous. Here we find the tendency of human escapism. Truth is personified as she breaks in with all her matter of fact, when the narrator was enjoying the idea that some frolicking boy had caused the damage. The narrator cannot avoid returning to the truth and responsibilities of the ground. He wishes for a temporary escape, either as an imaginative writer or a climber of birches. He's ready to face reality after his brief suspension of it. Birches capture the nostalgic memory of a countryside boy and fuses it into worldly wisdom of the grown-up man he has become. Swinging in the birch trees is like swinging between the opposites. There are many contrasts in the poem: earth and heaven, control and abandon, reality and imagination, escape and responsibility. And like all poems of Robert Frost, it begins in wisdom and ends in delight.